Hello, I'm Dave Mowitz, and welcome to Successful Farming. On today's program, I'm headed to a sale that features a 2012 Case IH Magnum 225. That tractor has 1,100 hours and comes with a CVT transmission. Any guesses as to how much it'll bring at auction? Then we visit a farmer in Iowa about his love of Ford tractors on ageless iron. The Shark Farmer, Rob Sharkey, is back, talking about the impact farmers' markets have on agriculture. And after these brief messages, we hear from our product test team to get their evaluation regarding a number of tool innovations. So please stay tuned. I've gotten a lot of questions about the magnetic-based drills that are on the marketplace, and Bobby Huffman, again from Medina, Missouri, was also evaluated this tool as part of the product test team effort. This is the Evolution EVOMAG. This comes in a series of different models depending on the arbor size that you get. And Bobby, you found that this is one of those tools that it was a kind of a tough buy to make for the cost, but once you got it, you didn't know how you got along without it before?
That's right. Yep, I'm glad I purchased it.
Bobby, what kind of jobs did you use the EVOMAG on?
Well, drilling anything, especially larger holes, you know, anything over, you know, a half inch hole, it's faster to use this than it is a standard drill bit.
Yeah, the slugger bits, they're unlike regular drill bits. They make bigger filings, right?
It makes a bigger mess in a way, but it drills a lot faster. It's worth, right. It's worth having the mess.
So the nice thing about the holes this drills, they're pretty burr-free and they're very accurate.
Yep, very accurate, burr-free. You take a center punch and mark your hole, and then the center pin of the bit goes in that punch hole and stays there and drills straight down.
Yeah, Bobby, you're building your own hydraulic press with upright beams, and you use this to drill those holes, right?
I drilled 1 3/16 holes in there and it blew right through them.
Really?
The magnet held the drill in place and we drilled them out, no problem.
So this would be one of the things that if you had a toolbar outside and you had power to it, you could be able to clamp this on a toolbar and just drill any hole that you wanted to.
Oh yeah, yeah, take it anywhere.
And the thickness of metal?
Oh, probably half or 3/4 inch thick.
Oh, and didn't take too long then?
No, pretty fast. Yeah. Oh yeah, I've matter of fact, I just bought some bigger bits weeks ago. So that came with those, and that did everything I wanted to do to that point. But I needed some bigger ones.
So this tool, the Evolution Tool Company, is based out of the Midwest in Davenport, Iowa. You've been happy with the quality of this tool?
So far, I have a couple of their tools, and both of them seem to be holding up really well for me.
Sure. So Bobby, these are not a cheap tool to buy, electromagnetic base drills like this. They can run 700, 800, up to 1,000 plus. Is that an investment that would be justified in the farm shop?
Oh yeah, I wouldn't want to give it up now after having it. It was a big investment at the time. I wasn't sure if I wanted to spend that.
You had to swallow hard, in other words.
But I had a project I wanted to do and didn't want to borrow one, so I went ahead and bought it, and I'm glad I have it.
Well, thanks for evaluating this tool, Bobby. For more information about the EVOMAG drills, you can go to evolutionsteel.com. Another one of our product test team products that we evaluated were the heated garments. These are from Milwaukee. These are M12, based on the M12 or 12 volt system that they have from Milwaukee. Gerald Joseph Hampton, Nebraska, tested both a hoodie and a jacket. This was the liner for the jacket, and then this was the liner.
That's the liner for the jacket.
And then there was a shell that went with it too. Mm-hmm. And they have like a whole line of heated garments. You received this last winter and gave it an evaluation. Where did you wear them?
Well, that particular one I took to Oklahoma hog hunting with me.
Typical and, farm duty,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, well, it had to be done. And so I took that along and wore it in the mornings when it was cold, and you could just turn the heat up or down, and it stayed real comfortable. I mean, and it, you had freedom of movement and extremely warm. It worked really good.
So it runs off a small little battery, and this is the 12-volt battery.
Right.
And then it plugs in with that little cord then on it,
right? That's what powers it.
And once plugged in, then you control it off the control buttons right up in this
area,
right?
Yes.
And you hold that to activate it.
And to turn it on. And
three ranges of what you want. Now, on this one, the other extra thing they had was you also can plug it into a USB port that comes off the side, and that you'd use for?
We can charge your cell phone or use your iPad or whatever.
And so when you were running these before, you said the battery lasted for what, not 2 days, but certainly a day's worth of
work. Yeah, I didn't charge it at all while I was hunting that weekend. So.
And you were warm enough.
Oh, yes. And everybody at the camp wanted my coat, but I wouldn't let them have it.
So would it be worth investing in, because they do cost a little bit more money than, say, a typical jacket, probably twice or three times the amount?
Well, definitely. If you're at, you know, in the extreme cold, you can adjust your temperatures and you can stay comfortable. You don't have to shed clothes or add clothes. You can just adjust your temperature right in the garment you're wearing, and it saves packing a lot of extra clothes. You know, this does it, pretty much does it all.
Well, Milwaukee has greatly expanded its line of heated jackets. Now, for example, the hoodie that Gerald was wearing ranges from $90 up to $110 to $120, depending on where you're buying it online. Now, the shell with the liner with the shell that I'm wearing will range from about $280 up to $310, $320. However, that includes the charger and the 12-volt battery. If you already have the charger and the battery, you don't have to buy those when you get the garments, and that would save you some money. Are you looking for a late model, high horsepower tractor for your operation? Then join me at auction to see what one such tractor sells for. So please stay tuned. Welcome to Steel Deals. Today's market for tractors is flooded with offerings. Dealers have been carrying unprecedented numbers of late model tractors with low, low hours. And this has put a powerful ceiling on auction bids for such equipment. That's why I'm at today's auction being put on by Steffes Group, as it features this 2012 Magnum 225 CVT. This would make a great planter tractor for a mid-sized farm operation. You see, it comes equipped with high-capacity hydraulics and Case IH's CVT transmission. That's an infinite variable transmission with seamless shifting. But what is such tractor worth these days? Late model equipment prices are in a huge flux, changing almost monthly, influenced by such factors as the price of corn or the large inventory of machinery on dealers' lots. Consider this. The average price paid for a 285 to 300 horsepower tractor dropped nearly 15% in 2014, and then it took another 10% drop in 15, and then another 7% decline in 2016. Today, I believe we're at the price floor, and the sale of this Magnum 225 will bear this out. So the old pricing rules of thumb from the past several years no longer apply to used equipment today. That is why you need to know the price range for a piece of equipment like this before heading out to make a purchase. This tractor doesn't sell for a couple hours, which gives me time to corner Tim Meyer of Steffes Auctioneers and talk about horsepower pricing. Tim, we came to look at that Case IH 225 CVT. That's a 2012, and it only has 1,100 hours on it. And it appears to me that would make somebody a great planter tractor, because that has the high flow hydraulics and extra outlet. Am I far off on that?
That's a great tractor and a great example. I'm glad you brought that tractor up. That tractor is a mid horsepower tractor, and it's the low hour tractor that we were talking about earlier.
Right at the low range of that.
that's the tractor that they're not making a lot more of right now. Get into that tractor at the right hours, put the right amount of hours on it, and in a few years, that tractor is going to be worth more than they give here tomorrow.
I've talked about this in the magazine. We're at a time, at a price floor for equipment right now, that you're seeing it the way, same way I see it. In several years, you could sell this equipment for the same amount you paid for it.
It's hard to believe that a tractor would ever be a good investment, but I think today is a day that we can say that. That tractor in today's market could realistically be worth as much or more in a few years, just because the supply is going to be down. There's less tractors being made today of that category.
With the bargains that we've seen in high horsepower tractors and four-wheel drives, that's not the case with this mid-power tractor, is it? They're selling at fairly good prices these days, aren't they?
I think so. You know, I hope to say that the floor's in. We've been through some tough times, at least behind us, and those tractors and the newer ones and the higher horsepower than that even. But I hope to see that tractor bring somewhere in the mid to high 80s, maybe in the 90s tomorrow.
Really? Is that because of the CVT?
The CVT is a bonus. I think that it makes a great planter tractor. Yeah. It doesn't lend itself to everything, but it's definitely, from a farmer standpoint and an ease of operation, a great asset.
So you'd already mentioned you thought that would sell for what, in the 80s?
I hope to see the mid 80s, yeah. Mid 80s, maybe low 90s.
And other tractors about the same price range in that mid horsepower range, equipped the same way as that we're seeing this fall, probably going into winter then?
Sure. The only thing that tractor's missing is suspension on the front axle,
right.
But the cab does have suspension on it.
Right.
And I think that, again, if you're buying a tractor and you're looking at it, the more options you can find on it, the bigger market you're gonna have when it's time to get rid of it. Because let's face it, you buy equipment to use and then trade or resell. And auction is a great place to trade equipment, and we tell people that all the time. But the more options that it has, such as three-point and PTO, the bigger buyer market you're going to have, the more people you're going to bring to the table, and the better price you'll get.
Thanks for the information, Tim. Let's watch the 225 CBT sell.
85, 85, 85, 85, 85, 85, 85, 85, 85, 85, 85, 85, 85, 85, 85, 86, 85, 85, 85, 85, 86, 85, 85, 86, 85, 85, 86, 85, 85, 86, 85, 85, 86, 85, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86, 85, 86,
The bidding just finished on her Magnum 225 CVT, which brought a final price of $85,500. How does that compare to the sale of similar tractors? This is when things get interesting. Remember what I said before about prices on late model tractors being uncertain these days? Well, the $85,000 given for this tractor is way under current market value. As proof, I found two 2012 Magnum 225 tractors with CVT transmissions and similar hours. Remember, this one had racked up 1,100 hours. Those two tractors sold for $105,000 and $110,000. And for good measure, I went to one of my favorite dealer listing websites, machinefinder.com, and there I found tractors similar to this one. They had dealer asking prices ranging from $117,000 up to $149,000. You know, write those prices down and write the $85,000 given for this tractor, because if you're looking for a similar tractor this winter, you'll want to know those values. Better yet, hit the internet and start searching before bidding or bargaining with your dealer. Besides machinefinder.com, some of my other favorite price research sites include tractorhouse.com, fastline.com, and ironsolutions.com. You can discover more information about equipment values and every issue of Successful Farming Magazine, and also catch my steel deals report at agriculture.com. Hey, for more information about Steffes Auctioneers, you can go to their website at steffesauctioneers.com. I'll see you again next week on another Steel Deals Report. Tom Ogle has a love affair with horsepower, and to be specific, this Iowa farmer appreciates Ford tractors and a Model 6000 in particular. Tom explains why this tractor was so advanced for its time. So please stay tuned. Our Aegis Iron feature tractor this week is a Ford 6000 Commander, which is near and dear to my heart. I actually grew up driving a Ford 6000, and this one's owned by Tom Ogle of Grinnell, Iowa. And Tom, you got this quite a few years ago at a farm sale, didn't you?
I bought this from a dealer up in Toledo, Iowa. The Ford dealership had closed, and a guy by the name of Stan Upaw had started a repair shop. Right. And I talked with Stan, and I told him I was looking for a Ford 6000, just kind of wanted one, because that was a big tractor when I was in junior high and high school. And he found this one for me. This was the tractor that Ford used to compete with the 560 International. Early on competed a little bit with the 4010, but really not, because it didn't have the horsepower that the 4010 had.
Well, in this particular tractor is the gas version.
Yes.
Which has kind of made it rare, because
most of the Ford 6000s were diesels. And the diesel had more oomph and more power. This tractor happened to have a gas engine in it. I'd rather had the diesel, but it had the gas, so that's the one you buy.
Now, this tractor was also famous for the selecto-speed transmission that mm-hmm. came with it, and that was the first real power shift transmission in
yes.
agriculture, wasn't it?
Yes. Ford came out with the selecto-speed in about 1958 on their 800 or 900 series tractors. Then when they came out with the 6000 in 1961, the first ones were red, mm-hmm. and they had that selecto-speed transmission, but they went from a 43 horsepower tractor up to 60-65 horsepower and put a lot more stress through that transmission.
Now, talk about paint. You're keeping this in its working clothes, and your plan is to do that. You don't plan to do much repainting of the tractor in the future.
This tractor needs to have some paint touched up on it, but as nice as it is, I'm just not sure that I want to invest the money and the time and the work to repaint the tractor completely. I may change my mind. I continue to work on those oil leaks and work on them, but until you get the oil leaks fixed, there's no point in spending the big money on doing a quality paint job on it.
And you use your tractors in the farm here, don't you,
sure,
as well?
Sure. This tractor, I've got a 7-foot rotary mower that I use on here. Sometimes I have an implement on a tractor, and I just leave it on there for a good portion of the year. And if I want to go mow, I go get on the 6000 and go out and put a few hours on it. Keeps it limbered up. It keeps some of that moisture worked out of the hydraulic system, out of the transmission. I think it's good for them. Tractors should be run a little bit.
So Tom explained to me what the difference was between the Ford 6000s I grew up with, that were just Ford 6000, and the Commander.
In about 1965, Ford came with a whole new line of tractors. They called the 6X series tractors, and they had that Ford split grill. So to complement those tractors, they changed the 6000 to the 6000 Commander, revised that front casting on the tractor to look more like those 6X tractors, and they called the tractor the Commander. Some of the changes they made on the tractor was improved cooling of the hydraulic system, and also they slowed the engine down just a little bit for a little bit better reliability, a little bit longer life. They lost a couple of horsepower, but then they continued to build the Commander from about 1965 through about 1968. And then it was dropped at that point in time and replaced with the 7000 series tractor.
Well, Tom, thank you for showing us your Ford 6000. I'll see you again next week in another Aegis Iron feature Tractor of the Week. The Shark Farmer, Rob Sharkey, is back, talking about the impact farmers' markets have on agriculture.
Every once in a while, Mrs. Shark Farmer drags me to one of these local farmer markets. And when I'm there, I have an attitude because I feel like I'm a real farmer. I'm a traditional production row crop farmer. And what am I doing here? I usually just hang out with a guy in the corner that drug a card table to it, and he's selling his old comic books and Chinese throwing stars. But as I'm sitting there, I'm watching the interaction between the farmers and the customers. And it really starts to make me wonder. These people know exactly where their products are going. So if a vendor at a farmer's market grew a tomato and they brought it, they know exactly where that's gonna go. They know that Mrs. Smith is gonna buy that and that she's gonna take it home and make a BLT sandwich. They also know that Mrs. Smith's husband is only gonna get a lettuce and tomato sandwich because her doctor said he needs to stop eating so much bacon. Even though she knows he goes to the donut shop when he is supposed to be going to the implement dealer uptown. But once he sees Mrs. Smith coming down the aisle, she's gonna take the big tomato out. She's gonna put it there because she feels sorry for her husband, even though she knows her husband stops at the donut shop. The whole town knows he stops at the donut shop. That vendor knows their customer. It knows that that customer wants a specific type of product. Here I am growing corn. I really don't know where it ends up. Sure, if I sell it to the ethanol plant, I know that it's gonna turn into ethanol. If I sell it to the river, I know that it's gonna go on a barge, and past that, I really don't know. I've just been driven on the highest price, really the way it's always been. But this farmer's market's really got me thinking I need to change that attitude. There's a trend in food buying now where people want to know exactly where their food comes from. They want to know ingredient by ingredient. And when I see people in the grocery store looking at labels, I get frustrated because I'm like, well, don't they understand that their food is safe? Don't they understand that we're doing a good job growing this for them? But here I am, not knowing where my product goes, but yet I'm frustrated at them because they aren't sure where their product comes from. This type of communication goes both ways. If we expect the consumer to understand what their food is made of, then we need to make sure we know where our products end up. If I'm selling a bushel of corn, is it gonna go to a company that is pro-agriculture or anti-agriculture? Is it gonna go to a company that wants a higher quality product or a lesser quality product? These are questions that honestly I don't know. But going to these farmers markets and seeing these interactions, I realize that I need to know. I'm Rob Sharkey, host of the Shark Farmer Podcast. You can find my podcast at sharkfarmer.com and more stuff like this at agriculture.com/TV.
Please join us next week for another outstanding show. I travel to Eastern Ohio to tour a farm shop that is small but mighty when it comes to getting work done. And then I track the sale of a Caterpillar 259B skid steer loader. We feature a farmer invention that converts a dry fertilizer spreader into a precision applicator. See you next week, right here on Successful Farming. Hi, I'm Dave Mowitz. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, hit subscribe right here if you haven't already, and click that little bell right here to be notified when we post a new video. And click here to see more great episodes from Successful Farming Television.